Good morning, class. Welcome to Psychology 4054, Behavioral Neuroscience. There will be a series of quizzes that will assess your content knowledge in this course, that will occur regularly throughout the term. I specifically quiz you on material from my PowerPoint presentations, the book I view as a supplement that should help you understand, what I present in my PowerPoints. And specifically, the quiz material should primarily derive from the learning objectives. I mean, this is not a rule, but more of a guideline. So the learning objectives for this first unit are to be able to identify the neuron doctrine and general information discussed in class pertaining to how neurons communicate. I would also like you to be able to identify principal components of a neuron, which should be review from 20 to 20. I would also like you to be able to differentiate electrical and chemical synapses and to be able to identify the structure of gap junctions and their roles in neurophysiology. What do you see in this picture? This image is a representation of one of the first micrographs taken in the field of neuroscience. This is based on a stain developed by Camillo Golgi. And it was first applied at a very fine advanced level by a scientist from Portugal known as Ramon y Cajal. Ramon y Cajal and Golgi did not agree with what they saw in this figure, which led to one of the first arguments in the field of neuroscience, in the burgeoning field, and quite frankly, the creation of the field of neuroscience. So again, what do you see here? Do you see a lot of individual neurons, or do you see one interconnected net? So Golgi, was one of the most famous scientists in the world at the time, highly respected. He was nominated for the first Nobel Prize. He would go on to win a Nobel Prize eventually with Ramon y Cajal, a point that I will come back to. But Golgi, who is of course also known for discovering the Golgi apparatus or the Golgi complex, he developed this Golgi stain, which allowed for the first time for scientists to look at individual cells in certain tissues, including brain tissue. And from his analysis of brain tissue, he became convinced that the brain functioned as a perineuronal net, meaning that all of the brain cells are connected and likely communicate using electricity. He wasn't completely wrong, a point that I will come back to. But Ramon y Cajal looked at this, used the same stain, and came to a very different conclusion. He became convinced that you could actually see sections or spaces or gaps, eventually what we call synapses, in between these cells, and suggested that there must be some other means of communication by which the brain processes information and does what it does. Here's just one beautiful quote, very artistic, good blending of arts and science and literature here, I'd say. But these are direct words from Ramon y Cajal, who was just mesmerized by the ability to view the brain at the cellular level for the first time in history. Against a clear background stood black threadlets, some slender and smooth, some thick and thorny, in a pattern punctuated by small, dense spots. All was sharp as a sketch with Chinese ink on transparent Japanese paper. And to think that this was the same tissue which, when stained with carmine or logwood, left the eye in a tangled thicket where sight may stare and grope ever fruitlessly. Baffled in the effort to unravel confusion and lost forever in total doubt, here, on this contrary, all was clear and plain as a diagram. A look was enough. Dumbfounded, I could not take my eyes from the microscope. And from here, he went on and on to conclude that there were actually separate cells, not a perineuronal net, like Golgi proposed. This led to the first disagreement in this burgeoning field. So now we finally have this stain that allows us to visualize the brain tissue. But what is the brain tissue at the cellular level? Is it a perineuronal net, like Golgi proposed? Or is the brain composed of individual neurons that are not connected physically at the biophysical level? So based on what you know, who won? of course, Ramon y Cajal, his thoughts sort of dominated the field and, really laid the foundation for what we now view as cellular neuroscience. That being said, Golgi was not completely wrong. There are electrical synapses called gap junctions that connect neurons and allow neurons to communicate directly without the exchange of chemical neurotransmitter in the synaptic cleft. We will go over that at the end of this section. I also want to point out that these two shared the first Nobel Prize related to neuroscience. Golgi was actually nominated for the very first, but he did not win it. You might also be interested in a little history of the Nobel Prize. It was developed by money from Nobel. And Nobel, what he actually did was he developed dynamite. So, all of this goes back to war and dynamite and warfare. You see a lot of scientific overlap with military, really very long-standing. Da Vinci comes to mind. Da Vinci was a, some would argue, a military scientist. He was, very well-versed in developing engineering projects to help the military. That's actually how he made a good bit of his money and found gainful employment. In fact, I once read an application that he sent off to be hired as a military contractor for some like lord that wanted, some crazy catapults or something like this. And it was pretty, first of all, it's important to note that he tailored his letter to the job. He only mentioned painting at the very last sentence in this very nice two-page letter where he brings up his military background and how he can develop new engineer new tools and weaponry that, would just completely demolish an opponent. At the very end, he's like, yeah, I'm also a painter. If you want to do some paint, like painting on the side, we can work that out. Just a vocational note there, don't so much speak about yourself, but how you're the perfect fit for the job. Even Da Vinci did that. So Ramon y Cajal's important observations using the Golgi stain and challenging Golgi, what became a very heated argument. These two did not enjoy sharing the Nobel stage together, trust me. It was very contentious, but the neuron doctrine was the foundational hypothesis that sort of created cellular neuroscience. And this is the hypothesis that the brain is composed of separate cells that are distinct, not only structurally, but also metabolically and functionally. And it can be argued that this is the foundation of all of neuroscience. However, it is also worth pointing out that the neuron doctrine frankly fails to explain our complete understanding of the nervous system. If you want to read more detail about this, I refer you to this article published in Science in 2005 called The Neuron Doctrine Redo. But in a nutshell, the textbook description of the neuron doctrine is being fine-tuned every year. So for example, I remember when I was a student, memorizing and learning about something called Dale's Law. Now, this is not a knock on Dale. Dale was one of the most prominent, famous neuroscientists ever, just like Golgi was a famous scientist. But everybody makes mistakes. And Dale was a very a staunch advocate that every one of these individual neurons is then composed of an individual neurotransmitter. So example, they're dopamine neurons that are dopaminergic. Well, we now know that isn't necessarily true. Even dopamine neurons that might have a lot of dopamine in them, they also have GABA, glutamate, gases, signaling molecules like neuropeptides, endocannabinoids. All of these things are involved in neural signaling or chemical signaling. So, just as one other example of, the science being revised, and neuroscience is a burgeoning, still a relatively new field. Some might argue that it is the final frontier of life sciences. After all, I think we have a pretty good understanding of how the heart works. How does the liver work? Now, how does the brain work to control its primary functions? Like actions. This remains quite controversial and therefore unknown. We still don't have great treatments for psychiatric disorders, psychiatric diseases. So I think we're still in a long way away to completely having a full grasp of what neuroscience is. And that's okay. It's sort of fun to be in a field of discovery or the final frontier of life science, if you will. But, you know, going back to the neuron doctrine, there are several outstanding problems that probably need to be pointed out. You know, first, neurons are not the single functional unit as originally proposed. There are astrocytes in the brain, a form of glia, that are capable of communication through glial neurotransmitters. And each neuron likely has various neuromodulators, like, you know, dopamine neurons definitely synthesize endocannabinoids that modulate neural activity. I've shown this myself. Each neuron may actually contain multiple primary neurotransmitters. Dopamine neurons have also been shown to contain GABA and glutamate. Now, it is worth pointing out that there may be a developmental component to this story. It seems that a lot of co-release, like neurotransmitter co-release, is most pronounced in development, and then the nervous system begins to sort of sort itself out more at the cellular level. But still, even in adults, there are plenty of studies showing that glutamate and GABA can be released from dopamine neurons. And gap junctions, I think, are probably one of the most fascinating things in context of neuron doctrine, because they show that Golgi was at least partially right. You know, gap junctions are electrical synapses where two neurons, are tightly coupled through these things called gap junctions or electrical synapses that allow communication to be conveyed without any sort of external chemical signal. That being said, there is little doubt that distinct neurons and their chemical synapses are fundamental building blocks of the nervous system and how the nervous system operates to control complex things like behavior. So not only are there individual neurons, we now know that there are approximately 80 billion distinct neurons in the brain that form around 10 to the 15th synapses. This is a huge number. I mean, it just shows how complex the brain really is, and in part why we don't understand how it controls behavior well yet. You know, but it is also worth pointing out that it is, generally taught, and something that I've taught before, that there are 100 billion neurons in the brain. This is actually an overstatement by approximately 20 billion, and this is, again, the human brain. And it is worth pointing out that 20 billion is a pretty big number. So, you know, it's really about 80 billion. Hopefully this is all a review, but from 20 to 20. But the way that information is generally conveyed through a chemical synapse is that the chemical transmitter and message would be received by the dendrite. And then, typically there's going to be integration, both temporal and spatial of incoming signals that are conveyed around the axon hillock, or the sort of the base of the soma, where the cell body transitions into the axon. You know, if there is sufficient input in one way or the other, you know, you can trigger an action potential along the axon hillock. Some axons are myelinated. Think of this as sort of like insulating wire, but there are gaps in this. And the gaps, or the nodes of Ranvier, are critically important for the propagation or continuation of the action potential. Otherwise, you sort of lose current. It becomes leaky. And I mean, there are plenty of unmyelinated axons in the brain. I'm a dopamine researcher and I've already brought up dopamine. I'll probably be coming back to this system a lot. But the most of the dopamine axons that I measure in the brain are not myelinated. Then the action potential would travel along the axon down to the terminal bouton. Here, the vesicles, most classical neurotransmitters are stored in vesicles that are then released into the extrasynaptic space. At this point, they can diffuse out of the synaptic space, activate receptor targets, do something called depot binding, meaning binding to non-active targets, or be taken back up into the synaptic cleft but through transporters. There are typically transporters that are located on the edges of the very far ends of the synaptic cleft. These would take up most excess neurotransmitter to reduce diffusion. That being said, substantial diffusion occurs outside of the synaptic cleft. And it's also worth pointing out that there are typically glial cells that surround the synaptic cleft that take up excess neurotransmitter as well.
I'm bio kids. Put your books down. Put your books down and report to the cleft, the synaptic cleft. I be Bobby Voltage, introducing the Glutang Clan.
Check out the synaptic cleft, but thanks to vesicular trafficking, a neuronal signal can be transmitted from electrical to chemical and back again.
Hot. Enter into the land of the nerve, where firing and barring will occur. Follow me, neurons gotta be ready to fire at any opportunity. Dendritic input, make it hot. Sum it up in the action hill lock. The potential will rise to a constant size. Shape of action potentials ain't no surprise. Snap back to the focus of the rap. A tiny little space, aka synapse. Voltage sweeps to the end like a broom. Calcium rushes in, vesicles go boom. Exocytosis, so exciting. ACH binds, light it up like lightning. Snap fanatics gather around. Questions about the story?
Do the transmitters always excite?
Now they can be inhibitory, depending on whether they do the ions. If K rushes out, positive charge gone.
Only one synapse? What if there's more?
The holoc will sum it up like I said before. The synapse is the location for neuron to neuron communication. Remember what Russ Fernall said.
The mind arises from the brain.
Now listen.
Open,
check
close,
out the synaptic cleft. Thanks
close,
to
close,
vesicular trafficking.
Ion channels.
A neuronal close, signal close, can be transmitted from electrical to chemical and back again.
Channels.
S to the inapse is where things act like capillaries and chemicals that make you relax or collapse. The synaptic cleft has receptors that bind to the synthetic ligands given by clinics that mimic your chemical condition. That's a small problem for medicine. 100 trillion synapses, drugs screaming
medicine.
For diseases, only one part of the brain.
Well,
a pill's not a sniper, it's a hand grenade. It'll act wherever there reside defects. Plus, everywhere else comes side effects. Don't wanna sound like a cynic. We've all got a protein they call nicotinic. It's a receptor that can't tell the difference between ACH and nicotine. Get a grip, but nicotine leads to too much binding.
So,
ACH receptors get to hide. Neuromuscular junction, it can't quite function, cause your receptors went out to lunch. Now dopamine's on for reward prediction, but it's down-regulating and you're getting addicted. Fixing to kick the habit with busted synapses, how tragic.
Synaptic receptors getting abducted,
a healthy synapse ain't nothing to muck with.
I hope this rap has been instructive, cause
a healthy synapse ain't nothing to muck with.
Open, open, close,
you don't have to
close,
leave
open,
the
open,
breath.
Close. Open, open, close, close, open, open, close, close, open, open, close, close.
A game of chess is like a sword fight. You must think first, before you move.
It's also important to recognize that there are these things called gap junctions or electrical synapses that do not require a chemical synaptic cleft, the vesicles of neurotransmitters that are being released. These things are not always necessary. So Golgi's view isn't completely wrong, but he did miss at least half of the story. So to go over some of the functions of gap junctions, I want to use as an example how the gap junction might play a role in neural injury in particular. They also have a prominent role in neurodevelopment and really neurochemical signaling in general. But their role in injury, traumatic brain injury, like you might sustain playing football or in a construction job or, serving in the military. These things involve, electrical synapses. And then if you alter the function of the electrical synapse, you'll see very different outcomes. So a lot of what I'm about to say originates from this source if you would like to read more. So in summary of this article, you know, it's important to know that in addition to chemical synapses, neurons also communicate through gap junctions or electrical synapses. Gap junctions are most commonly built by connexin 36. And, you know, from an old lab that I worked in, we demonstrated that, pharmacologically manipulating connexin 36 in the striatum, where dopamine is present, can alter things like cocaine self-administration. So, you know, this isn't only about injury and development. Like, a lot of these things have widespread functions. Gap junctions are most prevalent in early development and after neuronal injury. This could actually be related to cocaine. You know, maybe, when you take too much, you might see greater a role of the gap junction. But anyway, they most commonly connect dendrites to other dendrites or dendrites to the soma itself or the cell body. They facilitate neuronal oscillations, allowing electrical information to directly flow from one neuron to another. They're also known to form mixed synapses in which they can modulate activity of chemical synapses and vice versa. The current conception holds that they protect neuronal survival in early development and after moderate injury, but facilitate cell death in cases of serious neuronal damage. For example, gap junctions are increased by traumatic brain injury and are associated with cell death in severe cases. I want to go back to the mixed synapses just for a little bit, to hearken on a fact that, you know, these things, and a lot of neuroscience in general, is very difficult to study. Most of it can only be done using animal models. And of note, there are very few animal models that allow you to measure mixed synapses. The most prominent is actually the goldfish, believe it or not. Goldfish have very large neurons. I think they're called Mahler neurons. But these allow electrical and chemical synapses to be, they're very prevalent and are easy to study in isolation using electrophysiological approaches. There's really no other way to study these things yet. You know, computational approaches based on the actual electrophysiological recordings in goldfish could allow us to do this through computers one day. But I mean, of course, there would be no way of doing this in the human current. This schematic illustrates the influence that, or the role that gap junctions might play in neuronal death following traumatic brain injury. So in the cases of traumatic brain injury, or TBI, glutamate is a primary neurotransmitter associated with neurotoxicity that specifically occurs through the NMDA ion channel. As you may recall, there are three glutamate ion channels, kainate, NMDA, and AMPA. We'll get back to that later. But the gap junctions appear to contribute to the increase, and contribute to cell death. So during prolonged periods of glutamate-induced excitotoxicity, you see that the amount of gap junctions observed increases, and similarly, if you block the connexin 36, for example, or one of the gap junctions, you can see a reduction or a reduction in the amount of neuronal death observed, suggesting that the gap junctions not only play a role in the response to neural injury, but also can promote neurotoxicity.